So the question is, when do we use in the methodology number 1, and when do we use the methodology number 2? And we won't prove this for now, but we will keep that proof for a later time. We will do that proof in perhaps in the third or fourth lecture in module 4, when we talk about nonlinear systems. But what is required to ensure that these equations converge, the Gauss-Seidel methods when we are applied on these equations will converge, is what is known as a diagonal dominance condition. Okay, what that means with diagonal dominance condition. So if we look at this particular equation and we put it in the form Ax equal to b, our matrix A, we can write this as 1, 2, 1, minus 1. Okay, of these, again, these elements are the diagonal elements. Now, if the absolute value of the diagonal elements is greater than the sum of the absolute values of all the elements in that same column, in that particular case, we say that the diagonal dominance condition is met. So the diagonal dominance condition is going to be the absolute value of A11 should be greater than or equal to summation from 2 to n A1i. Okay, in this particular case, the absolute value of 1 is indeed greater than or equal to the sum of the absolute value of the non-diagonal elements. So for this particular condition, this diagonal element is dominant when we are looking at the first column. Also, A22 has to be greater than or equal to summation I equal to 1 to n I not equal to 2 A2i. Okay. In this case, the absolute value of A22 is 1, and the absolute values of the absolute values in that particular column, if we actually look at, this particular value is actually going to be equal to 2, and this condition is not met. So what we get with the matrix A is that the diagonal dominance condition is not met. In the case where the diagonal dominance condition is not met, we cannot guarantee the stability of the Gauss-Seidel iteration. So as we increase the number of iterations, the Gauss-Seidel iteration may not converge to the true value. However, if the diagonal dominance condition is met, that means instead of writing the equation in this form, we have swapped around this equation and we have written those equations in the form A bar is 1 minus 1, that is this row, and the second row is 1, 2. And of course, we have to change B bar also. Original B was 1, 4. Now that we have swapped these two equations, the B bar is going to be 4, 1. The solution of A bar x equal to B bar is the same as the solution of Ax equal to B. I will write down the B over here as well. Okay. Now, in this condition, in this particular matrix form, what we actually get is indeed this is the largest value in this particular diagonal, and this is all in this particular column, and this value is also the largest value in this particular column. When we have in general an n by n matrix, we have to consider basically that the diagonal element, the absolute value of it, should be greater than the sum of absolute values in the entire column for each and every diagonal element. Okay, so we will draw our two axes x and y. Okay, and the other line is x minus y equal to 4. So that particular curve is perhaps going to be represented in this form, and we will just extend it beyond. Okay. So, we will call this equation as x plus 2y equal to 1, and this particular equation is x minus y equal to 4. Okay. This point is essentially our x 0 comma y 0. Okay. So, our first equation what we used was we used x 1 equal to 1 minus 2y. X 1 we said was equal to 1 minus 2y, okay, 1 minus 2y 0, okay. So, what does 1 minus 2y 0 represent? 1 minus 2y 0 represents a point on this particular line. We are going to keep the same value y 0, y 0 is going to be 0. So, we are moving along this line to represent y 0, okay, and we will reach essentially this particular point. This particular point is indeed 1 comma 0, that is because it satisfies the equation of this particular curve. So, what we ended up doing is the first iterative step, we went from the point x 0 y 0 to the point x 1 y 0. So, x 1 is 1, y 0 equal to 0. Okay. So, this point is x 1 comma y 0. Okay. Then we used the second equation, so that we had y 1 equal to x 1 minus 4. Okay. Y 1 equal to x 1 minus 4. So, we are keeping the same x 1. So, we are going along this line and we will essentially reach basically this particular line. Okay. And we have now reached this particular point is essentially x 1 comma y 1. Okay. Why is it x 1 comma y 1? Because we know that the point x 1 y 1 lies on the line x minus y equal to 4. That is the way, that is the method in which we obtained the value of y 1. When the x 1 remains constant, we are going along this same vertical line. So, this indeed is the point x 1 comma y 1. We use this particular equation to get y 2, x 2. So, we will keep the same value of y 1. And we will go along, so along this horizontal line the y 1 value remains the same, and the point where that horizontal line intersects this particular line, that is where we will get the value of x 2. So, this particular point is going to be x 2 comma y 1. Okay. Now, we keep the value of x 2 the same, that means we go along the vertical line and find where this particular curve intersects vertical line intersects this particular curve, and when we project we will essentially reach over here. This point is nothing but x 2 y 2, we will keep the y 2 same and we will reach this point x 3 comma y 2, and when we project along this point we get is x 3 comma y 3. We are starting from the origin and we keep going in circles, and that circle or that spiral is essentially expanding spiral. So, the method that we are going to use, if x equal x plus 2y is our first equation and x minus y equal to 4 is the second equation, we are not going to reach the desired solution, that is this particular point. Okay. Now, an alternate way how we went about this is we used this particular curve to get x and we use this particular curve essentially to get y. Okay. And how that is going to go is we start at the origin. Okay. The x axis is the axis representing the curve where y 0 equal to 0. So we will use this particular equation now in order to get x 1, okay. So the x 1 is going to be the point where this horizontal line intersects this particular axis. So this is going to be our x 1, y 0. Okay, now we project along this particular vertical line. The vertical line, again to remind, it represents the line at which x equal to x1, and where this intersects this line is y1. So this point becomes x1 comma y1, okay. This becomes x2 comma y1. This point becomes x2 comma y2, and as we keep iterating we will spiral in towards the desired solution, okay. So if we are going to use this particular curve as the curve to get x and this curve to as a curve to get y, what happens is we start spiraling essentially towards the center of the intersection of these two lines. So this starts attracting essentially all the trajectories of the Gauss-Seidel iteration if we ensure that our system of equations is indeed diagonally dominant.